أيها السادة المشاهدون، نحييكم من قناة الميادين، ويسرنا أن نرحب بالكاتب الكبير والمفكر الأمريكي الشهير نورمان فينكلستين. فينكلستين يحكى عنه في الولايات المتحدة على أنه رجل مثير للجدل، وأي شيء لا يقبله الشارع الأمريكي الرئيسي أو الحياة الفكرية الرئيسية في الولايات المتحدة يعتبر مثيرا للجدل. لكنه في الحقيقة فينكلستين هو أقرب إلى الشعوب منه إلى الإدارة الأمريكية أو إلى الفكر السياسي الأمريكي السائد. You are welcome Mr. Finkelstein with الميادين here.
أهلا وسهلا بكم سيد فينكلستين على شاشة الميادين. في الأسبوعين الأخيرين شاهدنا حدثين رئيسيين يقعان في الشرق الأوسط وأيضا هنا في نيويورك. الأول ما وقع في غزة من حرب عليها من جانب الإسرائيليين، ثم ما جرى في الأمم المتحدة. كيف تنظر إلى وقوع هذين الحدثين في زمن متقارب للغاية وما تأثيرهما على القضية الفلسطينية؟
Well, there was obviously an interrelationship between the two events. What happened in the United Nations yesterday was the outcome and consequence of what happened in Gaza about 2 weeks ago. The two events mark, I think, a staggering military defeat for Israel in Gaza, and then in part consequently a staggering political defeat for Israel in the United Nations. So both on the military and the political front, these were major defeats. It used to be said about Israel, or some people said about Israel, that they were able to win in the military field, but they were never able to get the political advantages that derived from their military victory. But now things have changed significantly because they're suffering major setbacks militarily. And as a result of that, they're suffering even greater setbacks, failures politically. It is a changing moment.
عندما تتحدثون عن انتكاسات عسكرية، هل تعتقدون أنهم أساءوا التقدير باغتيال القائد الجعبري؟ ثم لماذا لجأوا لحرب كهذه؟ وكيف تقارن هذا بما جرى عام 2008 مثلا؟
You have to bear in mind that soon after the Israeli massacre in Gaza in 2008-9, really within weeks, they started talking about an Operation Cast Lead 2. And the Operation Cast Lead 2 actually, for a long time, never happened. And I had said at the time that I don't believe they can do an Operation Cast Lead 2 because of the new developments in the Arab Muslim world. Basically, the ascension to power of Erdogan in Turkey, and then the ascension to power of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, that's going to put significant constraints on what Israel could do. Now, when the last Israeli attack occurred beginning on November 14th, initially I thought it was just unplanned and spontaneous, but now on reflection I reconsidered that, and I don't think it was unplanned and spontaneous. In fact, it was Operation Cast Lead 2, but in a new political environment. And so the Israelis were effectively testing the limits of what they could do in the new political environment. And so I don't think it was spontaneous, because when you think about it, in 2008, Israel launched Operation Cast Lead when they went into Gaza on November 4th, killed six Palestinian militants, and they knew immediately that that's going to evoke a massive Hamas barrage of projectiles, and that would give them their pretext to attack. This time around, there's no question that Israel knew by killing Ahmed Jabari that again it was going to evoke a massive Hamas reaction, which tells me it was another pretext just as the one on November 4th, 2008. As it happens, it came within 10 days. The last one was November 4th. This one was
معذرة على المقاطعة. ما سمعناه أو قاله بعض المعلقين في الشرق الأوسط أنه كانت هناك مناورات تجري، مناورات إسرائيلية أمريكية يتم خلالها اختبار القبة الحديدية، وربما أرادوا اختبارها بشكل حي كما قالوا.
You know, there's never a single cause for a attack. there are always several causes, and just for reasons of simplicity, you want to get to the main cause. Yeah, I think they wanted to test Iron Dome, but I don't think that was the main impetus behind the attack. The main impetus behind the attack was that Hamas was accruing a large number of gains on the political front. It was gaining a lot of legitimacy. Now, for most people looking at it from the outside, what's the big deal? But for the Israelis, it is a very big deal because they have defined Hamas as a terrorist entity, a terrorist organization. And when they see this organization, which they've defined as a terrorist organization, becoming legitimate, becoming respectable, all of these Arab Muslim leaders are journeying to it. First comes the Qatari Emir. He says, I'm going to give you $400 million. Then there's announcement that Prime Minister Erdogan of Turkey is going to be making a journey to Gaza. The Israelis are getting infuriated. It's like the Arab Muslim world is thumbing its nose at them.
عندما حضر القطريون إلى غزة، كان هناك شعور محلي عام بأنهم قدموا حاملين عرضا إسرائيليا إلى الفلسطينيين. تخلوا عن المقاومة، نعطيكم التنمية. هل كانت تلك هي الحقيقة؟
That's not exactly right. The Qatari position, which is in part understandable. There was talk about the Qataris investing money in opening the border between Rafah and Gaza and turning it into a free trade zone. And the Qataris offered, were planning to offer $1 billion. But they said they're not going to invest if Israel is just going to come in and blow it up. And so what you talk about, what you put in terms of stopping resistance, there was actually a pragmatic motive. Namely, the Qataris actually went to the Israelis and said to them, if we put in the $1 billion and in a free trade zone, will you promise not to blow it up in the next attack? And the Israelis said, we're not making that promise. So you might want to interpret it as wanting to stop resistance, or you might want to interpret it as the Qataris just wanted to make a solid business investment and didn't want to see it reduced to rubble inside of a week with the next Israeli attack. We have to be clear about, when we talk about the resistance, what it looked like in reality. In reality, Hamas wanted to maintain the ceasefire. They were politically on a roll at that particular time. They were getting legitimacy, they were getting respectability. In fact, if you talk to people in the West Bank, and I do, they were envying the Gazans. They said, I think Gaza's doing better economically than the West Bankers are doing.
The last few months.
Right, right. Well, so in those circumstances, the very last thing Hamas wanted was a war with Israel, knowing how destructive it's going to be. So at that point in time, there was actually a broad consensus between what Qatar wanted, what Hamas wanted, what the people of Gaza wanted. They wanted, you may not like it, but the resistance at that particular moment took the form of wanting calm and trying to restore the economy in Gaza and gaining more legitimacy through its diplomatic recognition and also through its economic, relative economic prosperity. So on the Palestinian, the Gazan side, there was no motive or incentive at all for an attack. And it was Israel who kept needling them. Action here and action there, and then it put the Hamas in a very difficult position. If it didn't retaliate, then it's accused of playing the same role in the West, in Gaza, as the Palestinian Authority is doing in the West Bank. If they do retaliate, well, then you're actually doing what the Israelis.
في الوقت الذي كان فيه القطريون يعرضون المساعدات والتنمية، كان الإيرانيون يقدمون الصواريخ والأموال للقطاع، وعليه كان هناك استراتيجيتان في هذا السيناريو. الاستراتيجية الأولى بالسعي للتنمية، والأخرى بعدم ترك الإسرائيليين يأخذونهم على حين غرة ويهاجمونهم، وذلك بالاستعداد للحرب التالية. وفي هذه الجولة برهنوا أنهم كانوا أكثر استعدادا بكثير مما كانوا عليه عام 2008. أليس هذا ما حصل؟
I think, personally, I think that's a gross exaggeration. Now, I'm not going to take everything the Israelis say at their word, but some things seem pretty clear. There are only two or three long-range, what they call long-range missiles, that went deep into Israel. two went to Tel Aviv, one went to Jerusalem. The Israelis saying, I am inclined to believe them, they said these were rockets without any explosives on them. That's the only reason they were able to reach. That isn't. So, and they call them, pipes. These were not rockets. So all of this talk of very sophisticated Iranian technology, which had been, or weapons that have been smuggled into Gaza, to me it's really not credible. Gaza is a small place. It's constantly being monitored by Israeli drones. Gaza is swarming with Israeli collaborators, the ex-Fatah people. They're all over the place. If there were serious weapons factories in Gaza, Israel would know about it. Israel would have gone in before November 14th and blown them up.